So let me thank organizers for inviting me for this special meeting. So here's the picture of Lev Gorkov more than half a century ago, when I was first time met him as our professor in classical hydrodynamics. He gave lectures in Kapitsa Institute to to me and to my classmates on classical hydrodynamics, in our words, ideal and viscous liquid, shock waves, turbulence, and so on and so forth. So he was not only superconducting man. So today I will speak about type 2 superconductivity theory in ferromagnetic metals with triplet pairing. So it's, in fact, it's also based on some Lev's activity, because he was the first who derived a Ginzburg-Landau equation from microscopic theory. So I will speak about three ferromagnetic materials, uranium compounds, uranium-germanium-2, uranium-rhodium-germanium, and uranium-cobalt-germanium. They are orthorhombic crystals, and the F electron which create the ferromagnetic moment concentrated in all of them around the uranium atoms. In uranium cobalt germanium, also around cobalt, but very tiny in comparison with uranium. So we deal with, if you like, dual system which have a local and itinerant features of electronic subsystem. So now several properties of them with uranium germanium. So your Curie temperature is more than 50 degrees Kelvin, and superconductivity developed here at high enough pressure, above one gigapascal. But this superconductivity exists below the first order type transition. So this Curie temperature goes like this with pressure, and after three critical point, there is a first order type transition here. In these two, so in our words, the difference between the Curie temperature and critical temperature of superconducting transition very high. more than one order of magnitude. And here the same, so uranium, germanium, you see Curie temperature here, it's about 10 Kelvin, and superconducting temperature about 0.2 Kelvin. So looks like this. And uranium, cobalt, germanium, the most interesting material, because here we have coexistence of ferromagnetism with superconductivity in one part of phase diagram, and here it's just pure paramagnetic state, and this is a non-magnetic superconductivity. Important point also that these phase transitions between the normal and ferromagnet registered, between the ferromagnet and ferromagnet superconducting state registered, this also, but there is no phase transition here. So I will speak mostly about this phase diagram, but after when I describe a theoretical description, I explain this phase diagram. So important point here also, you see that when Curie temperature increases with pressure, superconducting temperature decreases, and here vice versa, Curie temperature decreases, and superconducting temperature increase. So it means that superconductivity appears due to the ferromagnetic fluctuations, because the superconductivity stimulated by the ferromagnetic ordering. And when we closer to a ferromagnetic transition, we have a stronger superconducting state. Superconductivity also unconventional because this Abrikosov-Gorkov plot into this material, uranium, rhodium, germanium, uranium, cobalt, germanium, demonstrate the separation of superconducting state by purity, by impurities. Also, there are a lot of data. I just choose one of them. The upper critical field in uranium, cobalt, germanium, about 30 Tesla. So at the same time, you remember the critical temperature about 0.2. So, Curie temperature much higher than superconducting temperature. So all these facts just almost we are almost sure that here we deal with not only unconventional superconductivity, but with triplet pairing. So if we deal with triplet pairing, it's useful to remind the situation in helium-free, which is canonic triplet superfluid. So the phase diagram looks like as follows. This is a solid normal Fermi liquid. So two phases, A and B. And A is a quite simple phase. It has an orbital momentum 1 and linear combination of pairing with spin up, up, and spin down, down with equal weight. So the B phase looks like quite different. Here we have orbital momentum up, spin momentum up. It's a zero projection of orbital and spin momentum. And here the state with orbital momentum up and spin momentum down. So recently there was discovered a new state of this liquid, a so-called polar state, which corresponds only this part of a B phase. It was discovered in Moscow by group of Vladimir Dmitriev in Kapitsa Institute. And phase diagram looks like as follows. So here the polar state and here distorted A phase. This stuff, it was predicted theoretically that if we fill by helium some anisotropic medium, in given case it's just a so-called aerosol nothing, which consists of aluminum 2O3 strands almost parallel to each other at distance about several millimeters and with diameter 8 nanometers and distance 50 nanometers. In this case, this intrinsic anisotropy make preferable appearance first polar state and then A state. So so now what is the relationship of this state to our subject? Here we have ferromagnetic superconductors, and in simplest case we have a two band spin up and spin down metal, and we have a pairing inside of this band with spin up up, spin down down, and scattering of Cooper pairs between these two bands. So the order parameter for triplet pairing, it's a matrix with amplitude of pairing up, up, and down, down, and zero projection of spin like this. So for simplicity, I will speak about only so-called equal spin pairing. So I neglect this part of order parameter. It's a long story. One can prove that actually it's much, much, it also exists due to spin orbital coupling, this part, but it's quite small in comparison with these two. So A state, group theoretical Group theoretical analysis shows that there are only two superconducting states in orthorhombic superconductors, so-called A state and B state. And A state looks like as follows, similar to A phase. You see that here A state at least two band and four component superconducting state, because there is eta up, x, eta y up, and also eta with down. So it's much more complicated superconductivity than usual superconductivity. Four component order parameter, at least. B state simpler, looks like as follows, kz times eta up and kz eta down. So the symmetry of A state, it's just in usual terminology, it's just ordinary superconductivity, conventional superconductivity, because we have here only gauge invariance breaking. B state, it's a more complicated symmetry. One can check that this other parameter is symmetric in respect of this group. So I will speak about, so I suppose that we deal in this material with such a type of superconducting state with two other parameters. The theory, the corresponding theory for A state also can be developed, but you see it's much more complicated because here we have four components. Now let's show the starting point. Actually, I will speak about these materials like type 2 superconductors because you see the ratio of London penetration depth to coherence length is enormous here, actually. So, and from this point of view, I must develop theory like Abrikosov theory, but ferromagnetic metal with triplet pairing, and due to this reason, there is a linear induction, in magnetic induction term of interaction with superconducting state, and usual gradient terms and electromagnetic terms. So the similar functional for a usual superconductivity was introduced many, many years ago by Blount and Varma. So, but here you see it's in case of Blount and Varma, this term, for instance, is quadratic in magnetization. Here is linear, and this combination is a time reversal invariant here. So, and Ginzburg-Landau equation, two Ginzburg-Landau equation in respect of component of superconducting order parameter, and one Landau equation in respect of component of magnetization. So here a magnetization M along the axis of along the easy axis. So in our words, I suppose that we deal with a strongly anisotropic ferromagnetic material, which corresponds to experiment. So, and also one need to add Maxwell equation to this. So we must solve four equations here to explain this phase diagram. let's start from this transition from ferromagnetic state to ferromagnetic plus superconducting state. here in experimentally was demonstrated that magnetization in ferromagnetic state at phase transition to superconducting state higher than the lower critical field. So if in our words, if we look on this phase diagram from the point of view of usual superconductivity, it's just transition at finite magnetic field to the Abrikosov mixed state, or Shubnikov mixed state, if you like. The phase transition was measured by specific heat, for instance, and for this phase transition, we need to find, first of all, upper critical field, and then we must calculate the decrease of magnetization of ferromagnetic state at this transition to the superconducting ferromagnetic state. So experimentally, when the magnetic field parallel to easy axis, the upper critical field looks like as follows. So first of all, there is a vertical path. This vertical path corresponds to shrinking of ferromagnetic domains with opposite direction of magnetization to the external field. So to calculate this this curve, one need to solve the upper critical field problem for single domain ferromagnet, two band, and due to this reason, it's a quadratic equation. So, and also, when one need to find the critical temperature from this equation, so because in absence of external field, the induction inside exactly equal to magnetization. So this is definition of critical temperature of transition. When you apply magnetic field, you obtain the dependence of upper critical field from temperature. So in actually, so and this dependence is a dependence just from here for single domain, because this vertical line, it's, as I said already, corresponds to shrinking of domains. Now, long enough calculation reproduced the Abrikosov formula for magnetization. It looks like as follows. So magnetization in superconducting state fall down. But unlike to Abrikosov case, where this corresponding expression looks like as follows, and in some sense it's a universal universal formula, very very beautiful, because so-called Abrikosov parameter is just a number of order of unity. Here it's impossible to express this in terms of one Abrikosov parameter, because you have two bands, and there is no cancellation. So cancellation of numerator and denominator for this normalization factor for these wave functions. So one needs numerically solve the Ginzburg-Landau equations and found these these normalization factors. And also, even if you neglect the second band, in other words, you put zero all these wave functions with index 2, even in this case, you cannot obtain this simple expression, because magnetization changes when you go to superconducting state. That and finally, formula looks like this. This is experimental dependence. Now, in our transition here, when you go from the paramagnetic superconducting state, actually any superconducting state is diamagnetic, but paramagnetic in spin respect. So when you go from here to here, and we solve this problem for a neutral Fermi liquid, you obtain this phase transition. Actually, this phase transition is absent, because because when you go in this direction, first of all, you have a well-developed superconducting state. And when you go to ferromagnetic superconducting state, you you just go through a Meissner state. So this direction, it looks like as follows. You go to a Meissner state here, and then you intersect the line HC1. So actually, this line is just a fictitious line. Now, several words about, of course, the equation is very cumbersome, and I will not present it here. But you remember, of course, that in Abrikosov theory, energy of vortex looks like as follows. There is a lambda, is London penetration depth, And Xi is a, is a coherence length. It's a flux quantum. This simplicity of Abrikosov theory is due to the fact that the amplitude of superconducting order parameter changes only inside of Xi, in distance of Xi from the vortex axis. And after that, the, this amplitude constant. But the magnetic field screens at distances of London penetration depth. And due to this reason, one can calculate analytically this energy of Abrikosov vortex. Here it's impossible because all equations interact each other, and two amplitude of two band superconductivity depends as follows. They changes on distances of also lambda. So induction changes at distance of lambda, and amplitude of superconducting order parameters also changes at this distance. So and due to this reason, one can calculate this energy of vortex only numerically and find the lower critical field, which is in absence of external field. This is just magnetization, m 4 pi mc1, if you like. And we, one can obtain this value from calculation of energy of Abrikosov vortex in this material times 4 pi over flux quantum. So let me just finish. So the phase diagram in uranium cobalt germanium looks like as follows. So we have a ferromagnetic superconducting state, which is in fact mixed state, and it was demonstrated experimentally. This phase transition is absent because it is present, of course, in neutral Fermi liquid, but in charged Fermi liquid, there is a screening and there is no bulk phase transition at all. So we have a Meissner state, then we have HC1 transition. This transition HC1, nobody registered yet because there is no measurements of this situation at finite pressure. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Vladimir. Are there any questions?
Does that state have spontaneous vortices, this M state?
No, M state is Meissner, sorry. It's a Meissner. Vortices is spontaneous here. I don't understand. Meissner state, it's a state without penetration of magnetization inside. So when magnetization inside appears, it was screened by the surface current.
Does the M state have uniform magnetization inside the sample or an oscillatory magnetization?
No. Uniform.
This is probably a stupid question, but I thought I saw that the coherence length was much larger than lambda in this system. Is that the case?
No.
Can you show us the coherence lengths that you showed earlier?
So coherence length is nanometer, it's a micrometer.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Maybe I have just one quick question. Since you have pressure, is that uniaxial pressure or hydrostatic pressure? Does it matter?
Usually hydrostatic, but recently it was not yet published in our lab in Grenoble. It was done measurements under uniaxial pressure, and there was found, it's in our subject actually, because if you apply magnetic field perpendicular to spontaneous magnetization, you obtain so-called reentrant superconducting state. So you, first of all, you suppress superconductivity, but at much higher magnetic field, superconductivity reappears. And under hydrostatic pressure, these two regions are initial superconducting and reentrant superconducting shrink. So this is a new effect which discovered last year. Just.
Okay.
Should we think of the ferromagnetic phase as an attenuant ferromagnet or a local moment magnet?
No, at the moment, for me, it doesn't matter because on the level of Ginzburg-Landau description, I just have internal magnetization, which of course polarized the initial metal. That's all.
But microscopically, it might be
microscopically. An issue. I repeat. I already said about this, that almost all magnetic moment concentrated, about 98% of magnetic moment, according to neutron measurements, concentrated around uranium atoms. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that it's exactly local magnetic moment. Mm-hmm. Maybe there is a tiny overlapping of wave functions and it's itinerant. Mm-hmm. But
follow up on the same question. So you take magnetic order as a source of splitting electron bands. But in terms of interaction between fermions, you take interactions the same as without magnetic order, or you don't care at this point? Right, so in this respect.
Actually, I do not understand exactly this question. Can I just
on the level of Ginzburg-Landau is probably irrelevant. It's a question about if we want to go beyond Ginzburg-Landau and
yes.
Look at what causes the superconductivity. In this question, respects the question is that
about
some interaction and in a magnetically ordered state, interaction also changes.
Of course, changes. But look, it's another story. A story about mechanism. And mechanism was described in another my article. So it was due to the ferromagnetic fluctuations. There are a lot of correspondence between the experimental data and this mechanism. And I even mentioned already. That when you decrease the Curie temperature, you increase superconducting temperature. So it's not phonons at all.
If I understood correctly, the reason you didn't show us results for the A state is simply that they were complicated. But is there any indication that there may be evidence for A or B in any of these materials?
There is evidence more or less for A state, not B, but A, because the upper critical field measurements corresponds to theory for A state, but not for B state. But actually, because you have two component order parameter even in one band in A state, the solution for Ginzburg-Landau equation, even linear Ginzburg-Landau equation, is so-called Sharman-Klem solution. So in this case, actually we have not two bands, but we have four bands. And in this case, theory, one can develop such a theory, but much more cumbersome. And my goal here was just made everything analytically from the beginning to the end.
Okay, if there are no more questions, let's thank Vladimir again.